I'm about to show you the most beautiful element on the periodic table.
Behold, bismuth, atomic number 83.
Technically radioactive, but it breaks down so slowly that our universe would have to be a billion times older for you to really notice. It's so safe, you can eat it. I mean, not like this chunk of crystal, but bismuth is a critical ingredient in medications you take to ease symptoms like nausea, heartburn, indigestion. It puts the biz in Pepto-Bismol is what I'm saying. And recently, one team of scientists identified another application for bismuth. It could bring about a mini revolution in electronics. You just gotta take a microscopic cheese grater to it first. Some elements start displaying some funky properties when you get small enough pieces of them. One of the most famous examples is carbon, which you can turn into a one atom thick layer of graphene that's 200 times stronger than steel. A team of researchers in Canada was interested in exploring what unusual properties they might uncover by getting bismuth as thin as possible. To do that, they'd take a small crystal, stick it on the end of a metal rod, and rub it against a plane of microscopic ridges to shave the flakes they needed. This was kind of a revelation because previous research required super fancy tech to get pieces of bismuth this small. Now, labs all over the world without access to that equipment can join in on the research with what's basically a cheese grater. To understand what the team found when they studied these super thin flakes, we first have to understand an electromagnetic phenomenon called the Hall effect. Way back in 1879, a man named Edwin Hall was playing with wires, magnets, and thin sheets of gold leaf. He found that when he had a current flowing through the length of a conductor, and he moved that conductor inside a magnetic field the right way, a voltage would appear across its width, which is perpendicular to the voltage you learn about in high school physics. Here's what's happening. A flowing current means that electrons are moving down the length of the conductor. Generally, straight down it. But the external magnetic field created by the magnet exerts a force on those electrons and causes the path they take to bend. They wind up shifting toward one of the conductor's sides. Electrons are negatively charged, so that side of the conductor builds up a negative charge. But that movement also means a positive charge builds up on the opposite side. So across the width of the conductor, you get what's called a potential difference, aka a voltage. The more powerful the external magnetic field, the larger that voltage. This is the part of the Hall effect you wind up measuring. But before we continue, we've got to run an ad.
Thanks to Jump for supporting this SciShow video. Jump is a statistical analysis software designed to help you with powerful analytics. When you have a ton of data that covers a long period of time, it can easily feel overwhelming. So Jump offers a time series functionality for you to monitor trends over time. And to get a jump on things, they also make predictions of how systems may behave in the future. That way, when it's time to analyze your data, you'll be ready. At that point, you can use Jump Pro features like spectral analysis and Fourier transformation for in-house data analysis. Jump has you covered through your whole data analysis process. You can check them out with a 30-day free trial for anyone, anywhere at jmp.com/scishow.
Eventually, scientists were able to harness the Hall effect for good. Or at least they were able to build some rather clever electronics that could monitor the resulting voltage and report when it changed. Generally, when either a magnet or the conductor was moving relative to the other. The Hall effect has been used in all sorts of applications, from anti-lock braking systems in cars to joysticks in video game controllers, which is all well and good, but it isn't the only Hall effect. If you get bismuth flakes thin enough, they become a great demo for what's called the anomalous Hall effect. Because, as it turns out, the Hall effect can also show up when a current is flowing through magnetic materials, even when there's no external magnet. These materials can basically compensate by generating their own internal magnetic field. Why it happens is still being debated by physicists, but one theory has to do with how the conductor's atoms are arranged, and how that arrangement bends electrons in a certain direction as they pass through. But there's a pretty important wrinkle in this story. Bismuth isn't magnetic. It's got no business having this effect. It's not the only non-magnetic material that seems to display the anomalous Hall effect, but bismuth is extra weird because of how persistent the effect is. The researchers looked at the bismuth flakes across a wide range of temperatures, from just above the coldest possible temperature ever, 0 Kelvin, up to a warm room temperature of 300 Kelvin. And bismuth's anomalous Hall effect didn't vanish at those warmer temperatures. The researchers don't know why this is happening, but they do have a working hypothesis. It goes back to that idea that the atoms are arranged in a very particular way. Bismuth might not be magnetic, but its structure winds up manifesting something that acts like an internal magnetic field without actually being an internal magnetic field. This property is called a Barry curvature. Now, for a lump of bismuth, you probably won't observe a Barry curvature anywhere except its surface. But if you slice that lump into something super duper thin, like dozens of nanometers thin, you do create something that's kind of all surface. Whatever is causing these bismuth flakes to have an anomalous Hall effect, it opens up new possibilities for physics and electronics. Scientists could use bismuth to study the even weirder phenomenon of the quantum anomalous Hall effect. Normally, it only manifests at temperatures below 1 Kelvin, but if bismuth is rocking a weirdly stable anomalous Hall effect at room temperature, it could mean the quantum version is more visible at warmer temperatures too. Any knowledge gleaned from that research, and maybe bismuth itself, could find its way into quantum computers. Meanwhile, bismuth's regular anomalous Hall effect could be used for some electronics in day-to-day life where, once again, temperatures are a lot warmer than the ones you need for other materials to display the same effect. And remember the Pepto-Bismol of it all? Bismuth is a non-toxic metal, and many of the metals we use in electronics for their quantum properties are not. Combine that with how easy it seems to be to make decent bismuth flakes, and subbing in bismuth could help make parts of the industry cheaper and less toxic. This is still very early days for this research, so in the meantime, I'll just sit here and admire my much bigger bismuth chunks and try not to eat them.